We have the pleasure to have with us today Matthew Rees from Harvard University. He's a well-known physicist with an extremely wide scope, which goes from particle physics, cosmology, to string theory and the Swampland itself. And has had a very fast career. He graduated from Santa Barbara in 2008. Cornell? And then you were a postdoc in the University of Princeton till 2011 or so, and then you moved to Harvard, and you've been there since then, starting as a postdoc and ending up as a full professor there. So with no further words, he's going to talk about broken symmetry clues for fundamental physics. So, Matt.
Yeah, sorry about that. So thanks again for the invitation and to the organizers. So in this talk, I'm going to try to tell you a bit about why someone like me who comes from a particle phenomenology background is interested in the Swampland program, which is what the workshop this week is about. So I'm hoping to aim this not only to those of you in the audience who are here for the Swampland program, but also for those of you who might be interested in particle physics or cosmology more generally. This is not advancing.
On the desk. All awesome.
Yes, okay. I guess it lost the focus when the Zoom window popped up. Okay. So the overview of what I want to talk about, symmetries, which are a powerful organizing principle in physics. But what a lot of us have been thinking about in the context of the Swampland program is that quantum gravity theories are thought to not have any symmetries. And so that's an interesting kind of puzzle to think about. Why do symmetries seem so important in the world around us when we fundamentally believe they don't even exist? Somehow there are lots of very good approximate symmetries, and a lot of the most exciting experiments that are happening are based on searching for small violations of approximate symmetries. So a question that arises then is, how good an approximate symmetry can quantum gravity allow? And so I want to talk about some aspects of that question. And I want to talk in particular toward the end of the talk about axions, is a place that I see as a particularly good target for experiments to make contact with these ideas that are emerging from quantum gravity. So let's talk a bit about symmetry. So we're all familiar with conservation laws, things like conservation of mass in non-relativistic physics, conservation laws in fluid dynamics, conservation of electric charge. And we're used to the idea that conservation laws have this kind of form, that there's some density of stuff in some region, the total amount of stuff that changes in time only according to some flux through the boundary, and we can write that as a local continuity equation relating time derivatives of some density to divergences of some current. And in the relativistic context, we can package that sort of thing into a conservation law, like the derivative of some four vector being equal to zero. And I want to remind you of Noether's theorem, which tells us that when we have continuous global symmetries, we also have such conserved currents. And the proof of Noether's theorem is very simple, so I can summarize it in one slide. You start with some Lagrangian field theory. You vary your field in a way that would be a symmetry, except that you make the symmetry parameter space-time dependent. You plug it into your action. Because it's a symmetry, there's no change in the action in the case where the parameter is constant, but there is a change that depends on the derivative of the parameter. And then we recall that on a solution to the equations of motion, the action should not vary for any variation of the field. And the only way to make that work is if this thing that appeared in front of that derivative is a divergences. Okay, so in that way, you can derive what this is. You just plug something into the action, you read off the coefficient of d epsilon, and that is your Noether current. And so this is probably the formulation of symmetries that a lot of you have learned from textbooks and maybe taught. In recent years, there's been a nice generalization of this, a different way to think about symmetries in quantum field theory, which I'm not going to talk a lot about in this talk, but I want to briefly mention it because it's kind of lurking in the background of a lot of the things we're thinking about these days, which is thinking of symmetries in terms of families of surface operators. And the idea there is that a symmetry charge is given by an integral of a component of your current over space, but more generally, you could integrate over any codimension one slice of space-time. And so in your Euclidean field theory, you can define a whole set of operators that depend on some closed surface sigma in spacetime and a symmetry parameter that are defined by exponentiating the symmetry parameter times the integral of the current. And these symmetry operators have the nice property that they're topological. So the conservation law becomes a property of topology, which tells us that I can distort the surface in any way that I like. And as long as it doesn't cross through some charged local operator, the correlation functions don't change. So this perspective was advocated by Gyoto, Kapustin, Seiberg, and Willett in a paper several years ago. And it's really kind of informed a lot of the way that we think about things now. Because this definition has the nice property that it doesn't only work for continuous symmetries. We can talk about symmetry operators like this even for, say, finite groups where we don't necessarily have a current, but we do have a notion of an operator associated with the group element. And we can also talk about these things for surfaces of different dimension and codimension. And a particularly kind of extreme case of this is going to arise toward the end of my talk when I'm going to talk about something called a minus one form symmetry, which I don't completely know how to think about, but it seems to be kind of a limiting case of this general thing. Okay, so that's how we think about at least continuous symmetries. And so far I've been talking about global symmetries, which are things that have these non-trivial operators that can act on the theory. But there's a different kind of thing that we sometimes call a symmetry, which is a gauge symmetry. If I gauge a would-be conserved current, we know that Maxwell's equations tell us that that current is equal to the derivative of a field string. And that means that we've turned the charge density into a total derivative. So now if we integrate it over space, it will vanish. That's what we call a Gauss law constraint. The integral over any closed manifold vanishes. And so all of these would-be charge operators become trivial in the gauge theory. So there's a big difference between global symmetries and gauge symmetries. Global symmetries come with all these operators that measure charge. Gauge symmetries don't. They trivialize all of these things. So it's important to keep track of this difference between global and gauge. Under global symmetry, states can have net charge. Symmetry operators exist. They're topological operators that measure some kind of charge that links with them topologically. And symmetries turn one state of the theory into a different state. And we should contrast that with gauge symmetries. There's a Gauss law constraint. The symmetry operators are trivial. And different gauges are not really different physical states. They're different redundant descriptions of the same state. Okay, this will play an important role in our arguments about quantum gravity because we believe that black holes don't like global symmetries, but they're fine with gauge symmetries. And there are more modern versions of this argument, but for the purposes of this colloquium, I'm just going to briefly summarize that we imagine that black holes kind of destroy global charge. So if you throw some global charge into a black hole, it will just eat the charge and forget about it. If you look at Hawking's calculation of how black holes decay, there's nothing in that calculation to tell you that a black hole would preferentially emit things with the same global charge as the black hole itself compared to the opposite charge. So we believe that black holes just sort of randomly emit particles of different charge and don't keep track of their net charge. The more modern argument makes a more sophisticated version of this that shows that you would violate some entropy bound if you had a true global symmetry charge that black holes could keep track of. But this is very different from gauge charge. And the important difference with gauge charge is that black holes that carry gauge charge have an electric field outside of them. So there's something you can actually measure outside the black hole that will tell you that it's charged. And this affects Hawking's calculation of the black hole evaporation. Effectively, there's a chemical potential. So we don't just have random thermal emission. We have a biased thermal emission that has a chemical potential that says the black hole, if it has positive charge, prefers to radiate particles that also have positive charge and decrease its charge. And there's another important consequence of electric charge for black holes that will play an important role later in the talk, which is that electric fields outside the black hole contribute to the energy of the black hole. So if I tell you that a black hole has some charge, there's a minimum mass that it's allowed to have, and that's what we call the externality bound. Okay? It's proportional to the charge and to the Planck mass. Okay, so our key belief about quantum gravity, which there's increasingly large amounts of evidence for, is that quantum gravity theories have no global symmetries, only gauge symmetries. And we should remember that gauge symmetries are not really symmetries in the sense that they don't relate different physical states to each other. Okay, so now I want to talk a bit about some symmetries that have played an important role in the history of particle physics. And so there's an old puzzle which is, why is the proton stable? Okay, we're made of protons, we're still here. But if I'm a naive effective field theorist living in, say, the 1950s, I could have asked this question. I can write down perfectly reasonable looking interactions that conserve electric charge that would let a proton decay to a positron and a pion, or a kaon and a neutrino. And yet that doesn't seem to be happening to the protons in the world around us. And if I wrote this down with an order one coefficient, I would predict that this decay happens very fast. The fact that it doesn't happen very fast tells me that this coefficient should be a very, very tiny number. So why so small? If I was a physicist in the 1950s, an answer I might have given you would be something like, well, there must be a symmetry. One symmetry I could imagine is baryon number. The proton and the neutron carry baryon number. If the proton decays to a positron, that would violate baryon number. It would also violate lepton number. And so that symmetry would forbid this process. It would not forbid the decay of the neutron, which conserves baryon and lepton number. So the symmetry seems like a very nice answer to this puzzle. But from the modern point of view, we think that's the wrong answer. We don't believe that there's a fundamental symmetry that stabilizes the proton. We don't need a fundamental symmetry to stabilize the proton. What we learned, what was firmly established during the 1970s when the standard model really came together, was that the proton is a composite particle made of quarks. And in order for the proton to decay in the way that I was sketching earlier, what we really need is an interaction that can turn two quarks into a positron and an antiquark. And that's a four Fermi operator. We can repeat our sort of naive dimensional analysis. And now we can say, well, it's not crazy that this has a very long lifetime. What we really need is just that there's some mass scale suppressing this, which is a high scale compared to the QCD scale, which would go in the numerator when we match this onto the operator I wrote on the previous slide. And so we need a high scale, say 10 to the 15 GeV. And this is what we call an accidental symmetry. Okay, so in the standard model, baryon number is an accidental symmetry, meaning that I can't write down a renormalizable operator that violates it. I can write down non-renormalizable operators. And so I transmute the question of why was this dimensionless number so small into the question of why is this dimensionful number so big. And that's a very different kind of question that, in fact, we have a good answer for the QCD scale, because we understand that it's natural to have an exponentially small QCD scale coming from the renormalization group running, that the coupling gradually gets stronger and stronger as we go to lower energies. Okay, so this is an example where thinking about things in terms of a symmetry might have seemed like the right thing to do at one point. And now we don't really believe that that was kind of a crucial part of the explanation. We don't really need a fundamental symmetry of nature to explain why we are not decaying at the moment. And there are ongoing tests that are going to improve our knowledge of whether the proton actually does decay. So one near future experiment is Hyper-Kamiokande, which is going to improve these bounds. It's going to take a while, and it's not going to be a super dramatic improvement, but still, this is something that people are actively searching for. Another parity, or another symmetry that played a role in the history of physics is parity. At low energies, the laws of nature appear to be parity symmetric. But fundamentally, we know that they are not. As was theorized originally by Li and Yang, experimentally discovered by Qianchong Wu, there are parity violating beta decays that showed that the weak interaction, these processes involving the weak interaction revealed that parity was violated in a way that was not apparent to probes of just electromagnetic and strong interactions on their own. And we now know that's because the Higgs mechanism, the breaking of the electroweak symmetry down to electromagnetism, leaves behind a low energy theory that's accidentally parity symmetric. So the standard model below the weak scale does not allow us to write parity violating terms. It looks parity symmetric. So this is another case of something that appeared to be a symmetry that turned out not to be a symmetry. And the fact that its violation appeared small at low energies was just kind of an accident of the fact that the interactions that badly violate the symmetry, it's really not even symmetry at all. It's not like a symmetry that's there and a little bit broken. It's the particles of the standard model have an intrinsic left-handed or right-handed nature for a given gauge charge. That apparent symmetry at low energies was just an artifact of us not having access to the right interactions originally. Now, there's another such symmetry, which is time reversal, similar to parity, which flips spatial directions. Now we're flipping time. Time reversal is a little bit funny because it's an antilinear operator. It complex conjugates things, but let's set that aside. It's still basically some kind of symmetry you could imagine having. And T-violating effects show up as complex phases in the Lagrangian that can't be eliminated by any field redefinition. I'm going to talk interchangeably about T-symmetry and CP-symmetry because we know that in relativistic quantum field theory, CPT is a good symmetry. So if T is a good symmetry, so is CP and vice versa. And we also know that the world around us violates time reversal or CP. The theoretical observation that underlies this was made by Kobayashi and Moskowa, who pointed out that if there were three generations of fermions, their mass mixing matrix has this complex parameter in it. And we now know in nature that this parameter is big. There's an order one CP violating phase in what's called the CKM mixing matrix. Interestingly, it's always accompanied by small parameters that correspond to small mixings among different flavors. And so even though this is a big CP violating phase, it always appears with small numbers in front of it, such that the effects are relatively small. Nonetheless, the symmetry seems to be badly broken. And CP symmetry is an object of intense ongoing experimental investigation. And this to me is one of the most exciting things that's happening in experimental fundamental physics right now. There are searches for a CP violating interaction called an electric dipole moment. An electric dipole moment is a term in the Hamiltonian that's basically proportional to the spin of some fermion dotted into an electric field. If we reverse the flow of time, the spin seems to go in the opposite direction. So we flip the spin, but we don't flip the electric field. And so such a term violates T. And electric dipole moments in the standard model are predicted to be very, very small. But in theories beyond the standard model, they're generically present and not necessarily small. And so if I write down new physics, potentially beyond the standard model, and here I've written down supersymmetric physics as an example, we generically have parameters in our theory. Here, these are mass parameters for some of these particles or couplings that contain CP violating phases and induce EDMs. And in fact, this diagram on the right called the bar Z diagram shows you that inside the box, I just have a loop of new particles talking to electroweak gauge bosons and Higgses. So we could imagine measuring an EDM by measuring the electron, but new physics doesn't even have to talk directly to the electron. Any new physics that carries electroweak charges and talks to the Higgs will induce an electron EDM through this process. So this is very, very generic. And the experimental bounds are extremely strong. So the current latest bound at the moment comes from the ACME experiment, ACME 2, which was located at Harvard. ACME 3 is currently being constructed at Northwestern University. The ACME 2 bound set a bound on the electron EDM of 10 to the minus 29 E centimeters. This E is just the electron charge. So this is the size of the electron dipole moment. They do this by precisely measuring a beam of thorium oxide molecules that are excited into some appropriate state that would have levels slightly split in the presence of an EDM when they apply electric fields in the lab. And they have a lot of ways of manipulating these particles and switching the direction of various things to cancel out systematics and do an exquisitely precise experiment where basically in the standard model, they expect to see exactly zero. And if there's new physics, they could see something non-zero. So it's a very impressive experiment. This number 10 to the minus 29 centimeters, well, first of all, you can just see that's a very, very tiny distance, much smaller than the size of a proton. So that gives you some hint that this is probing short distance physics. Here I can show you some work that I did with some of my students and a postdoc a few years back, where we just translated this bound into constraints on supersymmetric parameter space. So this is bounds on the MSSM in the plane of the mass scale of scalar superparticles and tan beta with some set of assumptions about how the various masses are related. And what you can see here is that if the CP phase associated with the new physics is one, this basically ruled out new physics up to 10 TeV. which is significantly higher than the LHC can directly reach. You can also see some region here. This is where the scalars become so heavy that their loop effects drag up the mass of the Higgs and keep it from being below 125 GeV. So you can try to build various models where you do different things with the Higgs mass, but basically there's some amount of parameter space that seems to be compatible with the Higgs that we see. And a lot of that parameter space is being ruled out already by these experiments, assuming order one CP phases. So these are very powerful experiments, and the reason they're so powerful is they're looking for something that violates a symmetry that's a very, very good symmetry of the standard model, but not necessarily a good symmetry of new physics. Now, there's a lot of other exciting physics happening along similar lines. There are searches for violation of lepton flavor, like U to E gamma, looking for very small branching ratios. The loop diagrams that lead to that process are essentially the same as the loop diagrams that would produce the EDM, except that instead of putting two electrons on the outside, we put one muon and one electron, so you have to have some source of flavor violation. But these are actually probing very similar scales of new physics. The magnetic dipole moment is also being measured at Fermi Lab now, confirming Brookhaven's old measurement. It's discrepant with what was sort of the agreed upon theory prediction before it was measured. It's not so clear that that's going to be the agreed upon theory prediction in a few months once all the lattice people finish their calculations, but we'll see what happens. What I want to emphasize though is that the muon G minus two experiment, it's an amazing experiment. It's amazingly precise, but it's not looking for symmetry violating your physics. And so it's much less sensitive. To explain this, you actually need new particles with masses of a few hundred GeV, not 10 TeV. So if you really want there to be new physics here, it had better have very suppressed CP and flavor violation. It had better respect those symmetries really well to contribute a big enough effect here without already having contributed many orders of magnitude more in these other experiments. And there's some interesting ideas that might allow that to happen. So one class of models I want to mention comes from Yossi Nir and Riccardo Rotazzi back in the 90s. Their idea was that so far we've seen CP violation in nature in only one place, which is the CKM. And where we see that CP violation, it's correlated with flavor violation. They're both happening at the same time. We might also be starting to see glimmers of CP violation in neutrino mixing, which would also be a place where there's flavor violation, but it's too early to say that that's been measured so far. So what Nir and Rotazzi asked is, what if CP is a fundamental symmetry of nature, which is spontaneously broken, but it's spontaneously broken by bevs of fields that transform under flavor symmetries? And because of that, you will see CP violation in places where you see flavor violation, but you won't see CP violation, or you will see it very suppressed in places that don't violate flavor. So CP and flavor violation might come hand in hand. And because EDMs are not flavor violating observables, that could suppress the EDM, even if there are big CP violating phases somewhere in nature. So this was a nice idea. Again, it's a reasonably old idea at this point, and it didn't get a lot of attention for a while. So with some collaborators last year, Yuichiro Nakai at the T.D. Lee Institute, Moto Suzuki, who is now a Harvard postdoc, Daniel Aloni at BU, and Puya Asadi, who recently moved from MIT to Oregon as a postdoc, we explored this. We extended this Nir Rotazzi idea to the lepton sector, built models that had flavor symmetries and fields that transform under flavor and violate CP, and showed that if we had just assumed there are new physics at roughly the few TeV scale, again, assuming supersymmetry as a test case, but the general pattern here should apply to lots of ideas about new physics. If you just put in generic flavor and CP violating parameters, the model makes predictions clustered up here, which violates the EDM bound by some five orders of magnitude and violates the mu to E gamma bound by, again, about five orders of magnitude. So that gives you some sense of how good these bounds are. If there's new physics at the TeV scale that's generic, you're ruled out not just a little bit, but by many orders of magnitude. If you turn on flavor symmetries but leave generic CP violation, you can do a bit better, but you're still pretty badly ruled out by EDMs. If you turn on spontaneous CP violation, in some particular way, but you leave generic flavor violation, you're still badly ruled out by mutate gamma. But if you correlate them along the lines Niran-Ratatsi suggested, you could have TEV scale new physics that's safe from all these constraints. Okay, so that shows that it's important to understand how these symmetries are broken in nature. The symmetry of CP, the flavor symmetries, are they fundamental symmetries that are spontaneously broken, or are they just not symmetries at all? And if they're not symmetries at all, then these precision experiments are really disfavoring new physics anywhere near the TEV scale. Okay, and for those of you who were at my talk yesterday, you'll know that I've been thinking about spontaneous CP violation from a different perspective, which I won't say more about in this talk. Just one more slide along those lines. By building a more complicated flavor model, the previous slide had just a U1 flavor symmetry, Froggett-Nielsen kind of symmetry. Here we put in two U1s, and then we can actually drive the constraints to such low scales that you could have particles at the few hundred GeV scale lying in this band that would explain U1 G-2 and not be excluded by flavor or EDMs. But interestingly, these predict the electron EDM would be right around the corner at the kind of 10 to the minus 30 level, which ACB3 is expecting to probe in the near future. There's also a forthcoming EDM measurement from Jilla in Colorado, which I've been told has been 2 weeks away from unblinding their data for the last 3 months. So I don't know what that means about when we'll actually see the result, but sometime in the next year, at least, we should see a potentially improved EDM result from them. Okay, so I think these experiments that are looking for time reversal violation are very exciting. They're some of the most exciting things happening in experimental particle physics. I want to talk about some other time reversal violating effects, which come from theta terms, and this is going to kind of segue into the last part of my talk where I circle back around to quantum gravity. So under time reversal, magnetic fields change sign, but electric fields don't. And so an E dot B term in the Hamiltonian violates time reversal symmetry. And we can add such a term. In QED, it would look like this, parameter theta coupled to this contraction, this antisymmetric contraction of two field strengths, which we also call F wedge F. And this term can be written, at least naively, as a total derivative. And so you might think it has no physical effect. But Edward Witten taught us that that's not true. He derived that in the presence of such a theta term, there is an important physical effect. Unfortunately, to see this effect, you need particles with magnetic charge, which we don't have a lot of in the world around us. But if you have a particle that sources B, you can just derive the modified Maxwell equations in the presence of this new term, and you find that a source of B in the presence of theta sources E. And what that means is that a magnetic monopole acquires an electric charge, which is proportional to theta. So there's this parameter theta in QED. It may be a large CP violating parameter in the world around us, but we don't know because we don't have magnetic monopoles to measure it. On the other hand, we can do better with the strong interactions, where we can write a similar term in QCD. Our field strength is a more complicated object because it's a non-abelian gauge theory. But just adding the appropriate trace, we can write a similar thing. And again, you might say this is a total derivative of what we call a Chern-Simons current. But again, there's something that reveals that there's actually physics in this term, and that's what we call instantons. And in this case, we don't need a new object in the world around us like a monopole to see an effect. These instantons are just classical Euclidean solutions to the Young-Mills equations of motion. There are localized objects in Euclidean spacetime with an action inversely proportional to the gauge coupling. So this shows you that this is some kind of non-perturbative effect. And they can give rise to actual physical effects in the presence of such a theta parameter. And one such effect is another kind of EDM. So before I was mostly telling you about the electron EDM, there are also strong bounds on the neutron EDM. They're not improving as rapidly. The best bound on the neutron EDM was set some years ago. But the neutron EDM is interesting because it's predicted that a theta parameter in QCD would generate it. And I took this cartoon from Anson Hook's TASI lectures. It's kind of a crude cartoon, but I think it gets the point across that if you think of a neutron as being made up of an up quark and two down quarks, if you just draw a picture of a bag containing an up quark and two down quarks, and you remember that the up quark has charge 2/3 and each down quark has charge minus 1/3, you're going to predict that there's a dipole moment just from this configuration of electric charges. And the only way to draw this cartoon that would not have a dipole moment is to have them all arranged in a straight line with the two down quarks on either side of the up quark. So superficially, that would look like a weird accident that every neutron has these quarks arranged in a line. But that's roughly what the world around us seems to look like. Again, it's a bit of a cartoon, but qualitatively, that's the idea. You predict that the neutron EDM is of order theta times the size of the neutron. And the most recent measurements put a bound of 10 to the minus 26 e centimeters, which tells us theta is less than something like 10 to the minus 10. And that's really weird because CP, as we know from the CKM matrix, is not a symmetry of the world around us. Unless, as I said before, it is somehow a symmetry, but it's spontaneously broken in a bad way. So this is a puzzle. Why do we generate a big order one CKM phase somehow from underlying physics, but we don't have this? And the best answer to this question comes from work in the 70s by Peche and Quinn, with further interpretation from Weinberg and Wilczek, which is essentially to promote theta to a dynamical field. So now we imagine there's a dynamical scalar field theta that has this F wedge F interaction with gluons. And you can argue that such an interaction will dynamically relax theta to a CP conserving value. Okay, so essentially this is some dynamics that causes these quarks to line up in this particular way, even if you imagine starting with a more random arrangement. And you can calculate that the mass of the axion is given by a very small number because it's a ratio of essentially the pion mass scale to some number f that appears in this Lagrangian, which we imagine can be a very high scale, potentially associated with fundamental physics. If that scale is 10 to the 12 GeV, then roughly the axion wants to be in the few micro EV range of masses. So it's a very light particle. It's light because it's inversely sensitive to a very high scale. So there's this interesting sort of effect where high UV scales become manifest in very low IR scales. So that idea was around in the 70s. It was appreciated that axions were a good solution to the strong CP problem. And then what people started to notice already in the early days of string theory, of superstring theory in the 80s, was that axions started appearing. Just out of attempts to build top-down theories, there were axions in the spectrum. And these days we can say even stronger statements. We have a large landscape of known consistent quantum gravity theories that contain gauge fields. I think everyone here would agree with that if I don't say that we're having to stabilize all the moduli. But we at least have a lot of possible types of string compactifications. And they almost always, when we find gauge fields, we find couplings between the gauge fields and the axions. And these axions often originate from some higher dimensional gauge field that had a fundamental Chern-Simons coupling that we integrated over some internal dimensions to get the 4D axion with the desired coupling to gluons to solve the strong CP problem. And again, this is an old idea. People have been noticing this in string compactifications for almost 40 years now. But something that was never very clear to me was, is this really a generic prediction? Is this something that string theory is predicting about the world around us, that we should have such particles? Or is it just an accident of our current abilities and the fact that we only understand how to compute in certain special kinds of theories? And I've recently started to think that there is something more fundamental about it. Let's see. Okay, yeah. One way to talk about that is to say that the axion is helping us remove some kind of generalized symmetry. One way to think about a symmetry is that there are labels that we can assign to states, their charges, that are these somehow topological properties. They're not altered by sort of small continuous variations of the state. And I mentioned earlier that there are these generalized symmetries where you can imagine defining things that are associated to different codimensions. So you could associate a charge with string-like objects or membrane-like objects. But there's sort of this limiting case where we associate the charge to instantons themselves, which are point-like objects in space-time. They're not extended. They don't have world lines. So it's not really an ordinary symmetry in the way we usually think about it, but it still violates this sort of idea that we shouldn't be able to attach labels to things in quantum gravity, that we can't somehow deform to change the label. And one of the most precise statements along these lines is what's called the cobordism conjecture, due to Jake McNamara, who's here in the audience, and Cameron Vaffa, which is the idea that different configurations in quantum gravity should somehow be deformable into each other. Okay, so imagine M and N are, say, two spacetimes you could realize in quantum gravity. There should be some sort of continuous path and configuration space that connects them. And in quantum field theory, we can't do that with configurations that have non-zero instanton number and configurations that have zero instanton number. They can't be deformed into each other. So this general notion that quantum gravity doesn't like this kind of thing suggests that quantum gravity shouldn't like the existence of this instanton number in field theory. And now for those of you who were at my talk yesterday, I'm repeating myself a little bit, but axions in quantum gravity do this job for us. They eliminate this instanton number. And the way they do it is when we solve the equation of motion for an axion coupled to gluons, we find that the instanton number density becomes a total derivative. And so now, just as we saw in Maxwell's equations that were of the form derivative of a field strength equals a current, here we have kind of a generalized version of that. The field strength is the derivative of the axion. The current is the instanton number density. And we get a Gauss law constraint that the net charge is zero. And this is what several of us participating in this workshop suggested. We should think of the axion as a gauge field for what we call the minus one form Chern-Bay symmetry, which is just the fancy word for this thing that counts instantons. Okay, but this is very qualitative. This says that axions seem to have a good reason to exist in quantum gravity, but we would like to be able to give better guidance to experiments and say not just that axions should exist, but something about their mass, their couplings, something a little more useful to narrow down where they might be. And I think we're starting to make some steps along that road, although we're not necessarily very far along it. So before I say more specific things about axions, let me just talk a bit about the weak gravity conjecture. So this is circling back to what I said early in the talk about black holes obeying an extremality bound, that for a given charge under a gauge symmetry, they have a minimum mass. It was hypothesized by Arkani, Hamed, Mattel, Nicholas, and Baffa in 2006 that every consistent quantum gravity theory should contain objects that have electric charge that obeys the opposite of that bound. So their mass should be smaller than their electric charge in Planck units. A black hole cannot do that, at least at leading order in the two derivative action, a black hole can't do that. And so if this is true, if there is such an object, then extremal black holes are able to shed their charge by emitting charged particles, which again, they like to do because there's a chemical potential, and decaying into a light charged particle that obeys this bound and a black hole that is not extremal. And if you believe such a bound for electric objects, you could also postulate such a bound for magnetic objects with the change that now the magnetic coupling is not E, it's 2 pi over E from Dirac quantization. And this led them to a much more interesting statement. Okay, so maybe I should say this statement by itself, you can't get a lot of mileage out of it. In particular, for electromagnetism in the world around us, this is easily obeyed by the electron. The gauge coupling in QED is about 0.3. The electron mass is nowhere near 0.3 in Planck. It obeys this with many, many orders of magnitude to spare. So you're not even close to having kind of an interesting test of the statement. But they were able to turn this magnetic statement into something more interesting. And to explain that, let me remind you about the classical radius of an object. So if we talk about the classical radius of the electron, that's the distance at which, if we integrate the classical self-energy stored in the electric field down to that radius, we get the mass. So the classical radius looks like this. It has a factor of the coupling. It has a factor of alpha, the prime structure constant in it. We also talk about the Compton radius, which I've labeled RQ. The Q is not for Compton, it's for quantum, which is just 1 over the mass. And at this length scale, you expect quantum effects of virtual electron and positron pairs to somehow screen the charge. So for the electron, the classical radius is much smaller than the quantum radius because of that factor of alpha, which is a small number. And that's why, kind of after quantum mechanics was developed, people stopped worrying about the classical electron self-energy puzzle, because we believe that quantum mechanics comes in before you ever hit that scale. But for magnetically charged objects, it's very different. For magnetically charged objects, now we exchange the coupling with 1 over the coupling. Where we had an alpha before, we now have a 1 over alpha. And now the classical radius is much bigger than the quantum radius. And so magnetically charged objects have this property that there is some scale at which something new should happen that's not just explained by quantum mechanics. So there's some, you expect magnetic monopoles to have some kind of internal structure inside their core that explains why you shouldn't keep integrating the self-energy and getting a number much, much bigger than the actual mass that you see. And what Arkani Hamed, Matul, Nicolas, and Vafov said in their paper on the weak gravity conjecture was that you get something interesting if you combine this magnetic weak gravity conjecture with this bound on the radius, which is that if you interpret that classical radius as a cutoff where new things should appear, you just put these things together and you learn that that cutoff is smaller than the coupling times in. Let's see, sorry, let me linger on that for a second. This is an interesting statement because it means that if I have a gauge theory where the coupling is very small, my cutoff becomes very low. And that is a powerful statement. The statement that some electrically charged particle should exist is not very powerful, but the statement that the theory is going to break down, that there's a UV cutoff, is a useful and powerful statement. And it also reflects this idea that quantum gravity doesn't have global symmetries, because if we try to make E very, very small, we kind of get closer and closer to electromagnetism looking like a global symmetry. I don't think I want to linger on the details of this slide. I just want to mention that there's a different way to derive the same statement, which is just by demanding that you should have some magnetic monopole that does not collapse into a black hole, in the sense that its Schwarzschild radius should be smaller than its classical radius. That actually leads to exactly the same conclusion. Okay, so they've told us there's some sort of cutoff. And then the interesting question is, what happens at that cutoff? And what has happened, work by a lot of people in this room over the last several years has helped to refine that. So Ben Heidenreich, Tom Rudelius, and I, in a couple of papers, along with Miguel Montero, Gary Hsu, and Pablo Soler, in a paper at the same time, and a little bit of related work a little later by Andrea Lo, Jung-Hans, Noumi, and Hsu, have postulated a set of ideas that we now call lattice or tower versions of the weak gravity conjecture, which say that what happens at that scale is actually that you have an infinite tower of many different electrically charged particles. And there's kind of a smooth interpolation between heavy electrically charged objects that are black holes and lighter electrically charged objects that are not, and that have mass much smaller than their extremality bound. Okay, so this is getting more concrete and a little sharper and more useful. And we have a lot of evidence for this from string theory and also from kind of qualitative arguments. Again, those of you who are here for the workshop are very familiar with a lot of this, but for the rest of the audience, maybe not. What I want to talk about in my last few slides are connecting all of this with axions. So I was telling you that axions are very well motivated objects. They solve the strong CP problem. They seem to be banishing some sort of generalized unwanted global symmetry in our theory. There's a generalization of the weak gravity conjecture to gauge fields that are different kinds of P forms, which in general says there's some charged object, which is now has a P-dimensional world volume. And the tension of that object should be smaller than the generalized coupling of the P-form gauge field times the Planck scale. And I've tried to argue that axions seem to be behaving like gauge fields in many ways. In fact, already, again, in that original paper on the weak gravity conjecture, it was suggested that we should think of axions as zero-form gauge fields. The objects that carry charge are the instantons. They have zero-dimensional world volume. They're point-like in space-time. And the analog of the coupling constant E is 1 over the axion decay constant. Okay. So the generalized weak gravity conjecture applied to axions tells us that there should be some charged object, which is an instanton, whose action is smaller than M Planck divided by the decay constant. Okay, so the first thing I want to point out about this is that we can just directly apply this to an axion that solves the strong CP problem. If an axion solves the strong CP problem, its dominant potential should come from QCD. That's why it solves the strong CP problem. And so the leading instantons that appear should be QCD instantons. And these QCD instantons have an action given by G squared over 8 pi squared. Sorry, by 8 pi squared over G squared. This is 1 over the action. So if I plug that in, I derive that the decay constant is bounded above by G squared over 8 pi squared times M Planck for a QCD axion that could solve the strong CP problem. And this is a simple inference from this old idea, but it's already phenomenologically interesting, because if you plug in these numbers, you get a bound that F should be less than something like 10 to the 16 GeV. Now, there's a little bit of ambiguity in what I should plug in here, because the gauge coupling, of course, runs. And the QCD gauge coupling at some point becomes very big at low energies. And we don't yet have a super sharp quantitative version of this axion weak gravity conjecture where we can nail down what all the numbers are supposed to mean. But a reasonable inference should be that we want to evaluate this running gauge coupling at some high scale that's related to this F. And so I should be plugging in a UV value of G, which is a small number. And that's how I'm getting this out, basically plugging in the gut scale value of the coupling. Okay, so with some assumptions, you get a non-trivial prediction. And here I've put a fairly recent plot of current constraints on QCD axions. This is the axion mass on the horizontal axis. This is the axion coupling to photons on the vertical axis. The axion coupling to photons, we expect to be a loop factor divided by the scale F. And the axion mass, as I mentioned earlier, we expect to be something like the pion mass times the pion decay constant divided by this F. And so so you can work out, let's see, did I put it here or not? No, okay, I didn't draw this on the slide, but you can work out where this 10 to the 16 GeV FA would sit in terms of the mass of the QCD axion, and it's somewhere around here, around a little below the nano EV mass scale. And so one interesting thing that you notice is that there's not a lot going on to the left of that in terms of experiments. There are some interesting bounds from black hole super radiance. And then there's kind of a gap. Now, on the one hand, maybe that's pessimistic because it means it wouldn't be easy to falsify the statement by discovering an axion in that window. But on the other hand, it means that the favored region from the viewpoint of these quantum gravity arguments is the region that is being tested. Basically, this DM radio bound is kind of a maybe somewhat optimistic, but not crazy idea of where axion experiments might be sitting after the next, say, 15 or 20 years of progress. And the region to the right of that is the region that's favored by the weak gravity conjecture. Okay. Now, I also want to talk a little bit about some ideas that some of us have been exploring related to axion strings and how to think about axion strings in the context of the weak gravity conjecture and the swampland. Every axion has a magnetic dual, which is a two-form gauge field. So just like I would dualize the electromagnetic field strength, I dualize this field strength d theta into a three-form dB, where B is a two-form gauge field. And the objects that are charged under that two-form gauge field are strings. And these axion strings are objects that are one-dimensional, one-dimensional objects. They have two-dimensional world sheets when they propagate through time. And the axion value circles around from 0 to 2 pi as you circle the string. Now, we can apply the magnetic weak gravity conjecture to the axion string. Now it says the tension of this two-dimensional object should be bounded by the product of the coupling and the Planck scale. We said the coupling of the axion was 1 over f, and so the magnetic coupling is 2 pi over that, so it's 2 pi times f. So we get a bound that the tension should be smaller than f times m. And then if I plug in the bound from the previous slide on f for a QCD axion, or more generally any axion where the relevant instantons for the electric axion weak gravity conjecture or gauge theory instantons, what I get on the right-hand side of this is g squared over 4 pi times m Planck squared. Okay, so the smaller the gauge coupling is of the gauge fields the axion couples to, the smaller the tension of the strings from the magnetic weak gravity conjecture. In particular, there are string excitations with mass of order g times m Planck. If I imagine that I can make little loops of the string where the mass scale of the loop is set by the square root of the tension. Certainly that's true for fundamental strings. It's also clear that you can make big classical axion strings for the case where the string is not a fundamental string, but something like a D-brain, it's maybe less clear that the very low-lying modes are calculable. But if I just sort of naively do dimensional analysis, this is where I would expect them to be. And this is the scale of the weak gravity conjecture, gauge coupling times the Planck scale. I also want to mention that this bound is consistent with another way to think about our expectations of quantum gravity, which is that we expect symmetry violating effects to be at least as big as the effects of small black holes, where we get some e to the minus s from the entropy of the black hole. So if I have a quantum gravity cutoff at a scale lambda, I might think that my symmetry violating effects should be at least as big as e to the minus 8 pi squared m Planck squared over lambda squared, which is the entropy e to the minus s of the black hole of size lambda. And if I say that my symmetry violating effect here is set by e to the minus instanton action, and I compare this to this, it's compatible as long as lambda is less than g times m Planck. Okay. So that's another way that the same parametric relationship falls out of some general thinking about quantum gravity. Okay, and that also keeps happening. This kind of thing keeps happening, and that we have many of these different ways of thinking about our expectations about quantum gravity. We have arguments about black holes. We have the weak gravity conjecture. We have these other things like the Swampland distance conjecture. And it often works out that you can come at things from more than one angle and you keep getting kind of the same conclusion from different directions. So this is one of those places. We can say more about these strings, which is that not only do they seem to have a tension at this weak gravity scale, but they also have charged modes. And this follows from very general physics explained by Kurt Kallen and Jeff Harvey in 1985, which is that in the presence of an axion coupling to gauge fields, you must have degrees of freedom living on the axion strings that transform under those gauge interactions. This is called anomaly inflow. One way to argue this is that if you start with this theta F wedge F term, and then you try to dualize your Lagrangian to write it in terms of the magnetic field B instead of the axion field theta, the way that you dualize the theory ordinarily doesn't work in the presence of this Chern-Simons interaction. You have what's called a modified Bianchi identity, and to make sense of it, you have to allow your magnetic gauge field B to change when the ordinary gauge field A changes under a gauge transformation. So if A changes to A plus D lambda, B has to change by lambda times the field strength of A. And that means that if I want to write down a Lagrangian on this world line, on the world sheet, I mean, of the string, where it's coupled to the gauge field B, I can't just write the integral of B because it's not gauge invariant. I have to write the integral of B plus other stuff localized on this world sheet, where that other stuff transforms under the A gauge transformation in the right way to cancel this lambda. And so there have to be charge modes living on the string. And in that way, we know that we can form objects that carry charge, gauge charge, which are just loops of axion string with excitations of the charge modes that live on the string. So what I've shown you here, this was something that Ben Heidenreich and Tom Redelius and I argued in a paper last year, is that if we consider an axion coupled to gauge fields and make a few reasonable seeming assumptions, so we're assuming the axion versions of the weak gravity conjecture, both electric and magnetic, we're assuming that the gauge theory instantons are the ones that we should use for the axion WGC. With those assumptions, we learn that there are these objects that are charged strings, loops of string that carry charge. Okay. So if I zoom out, these look like charged particles, and they are at the mass scale g times m Planck, which is roughly the mass scale where tower versions of the weak gravity conjecture tell us to expect a whole family of charged things. Well, here is a family of charged things. Now, there are some assumptions that went into this, and there are some squiggles, so I can't say that these things obey the bound up to order one numbers. But at least parametrically, they seem to be in the right place. Now, I used instantons in this argument. You might say, well, only non-abelian theories have instantons. And so in my last minute or two, I want to just briefly tell you about another thing that I did last year. This is work in collaboration with Gigi Fan, Katie Fraser, and John Stout. We argued that, in fact, there's something very much like an instanton that arises even in the abelian gauge. And that comes from a loop of magnetic monopoles. So the argument is that magnetic monopoles in theories that have axions admit a whole family of dion excitations. You can give them electric charge and turn them into dions, and they have a mass that depends on the value of the axion field. You can show this explicitly for certain kinds of theories, like a Tolkachev monopoles, but it really has to follow in general just from the Witten effect. It's really, again, there's a way to think of this as a kind of anomaly inflow onto the monopole world line that tells you this degree of freedom has to be here. And the effective theory on the monopole world line is basically just quantum mechanics of a particle on a circle. That's the mode that gives it this dion charge. And this is just the mass spectrum, the energy spectrum for quantum mechanics of a particle on a circle in the presence of a theta term. So we have particles with theta-dependent mass. And that means that if we integrate them out, we get a theta-dependent vacuum. So we can just calculate a Coleman-Weinberg potential. And we did that. You can sum up this tower of dions. There's also a different way to do the calculation where you Poisson resum the series that you get. And you can write it in terms of winding of the dion zero mode over the monopole world line. So you can get a sum over some winding number L. And in that way of writing things, you get the series of exponentially suppressed terms, e to the minus winding number times something that looks like an instanton action. And in fact, this instanton action is related to the monopole mass divided by the splitting among the dions. Parametrically goes like 1 over gauge coupling squared. You can do this more exactly for the case of the critical Tolkachev monopole, and there you find this action looks exactly like the SU2 instanton. So the U1 theory has its own instantons. They come from these dion loops. And in cases where you got that U1 by Higgs and non-abelian theory, they seem to be continuously connected to those non-abelian instantons and to have the same action. Okay, so this is a new source of a non-perturbative axion potential that comes from virtual magnetic monopoles. any axion that interacts with the standard model photon should get some minimal amount of mass from this. Calculating that minimal amount of mass is tricky because there's another story attached to this that I haven't told you, which is if I have light charged fermions in the theory, this calculation changes. That change is related to something called the Kalin-Rubikov effect, and there's a long and interesting story that we're still in the process of nailing down the details of to get the right number in front. Okay, but the upshot of all of this is that I think abelian theories in quantum gravity have to have monopoles. If there are axions interacting with these gauge fields, they will have all of this extra structure too. And so there's naturally something that plays the role of an instanton, which means this argument I gave you before about axion strings that relied on instantons, I think also carries over to the abelian case. Okay, so let me conclude now. We have a lot of approximate symmetries in the world around us. We have baryon number, we have lepton number, we have parity, we have flavor symmetries. We have even more generalized symmetries, things like instanton number that are kind of exotic symmetries that we don't fully know how to think about yet. In fact, since I originally prepared this talk, there have been even more symmetries people have found in the standard model that are non-invertible symmetries that are also very interesting. So we have a lot of symmetries in the world around us, at least approximately. But we also believe that quantum gravity tells us that fundamentally we don't have any of these symmetries. And so whatever symmetries we see should be some sort of approximate remnants, some sort of approximate symmetries that are enforced by UV physics. And so these approximate symmetries that we see are somehow shining a light on physics at very high energies that we haven't understood yet. And there are a lot of important experiments going on that are quantifying symmetry breaking, searches for EDM, searches for flavor violation, proton decay, axion searches. And I think that the outcomes of these experiments can shed a lot of light on fundamental questions. And in particular, I emphasize axion physics because I think this is really a great arena where we can try to make quantitative statements about quantum gravity using things like the weak gravity conjecture. And these quantitative statements might find tests in real world experiments. So thank you.
Thanks, Matt, for this very nice talk. So it's time for comments or questions in the audience. Fernando?
Very nice to talk, Matt. Just a couple of minor points. Question about the experimental part. What is the time frame of this experiment, for instance, for the axions to cover essentially the whole range of parameters for the proton decay experiments?
Yeah, let's see. So for the axion experiments, I think it's not going to be extremely soon. So what I think are sort of filling in little spikes around decay constants of 10 to the 12, 10 to the 11 GeV. The proposed experiments that are really ambitious that are going to try to get a big region here are mostly DM radio and maybe to some extent Casper. Those are at much more early stages. They're doing kind of small scale tests, but those are not going to reach the QCD axion line immediately. They're going to be ruling out areas up here and then gradually working their way down. So I think it's going to be more than a decade before we start seeing really substantial parts of this being covered, unless someone just gets lucky and discovers it with one of the targeted experiments that's probing a narrow mass range. But I think there are reasonable looking proposals that within 20 years, maybe we'll cover most of this. I don't have a very authoritative statement about what the timeline is. That's my rough sense. Let's see, in terms of proton decay, I'm not completely sure of the timeline of hyper-K either. I think it's expecting to start running in the relatively near future, and it will run for 10 years to get this kind of sensitivity, which is 10 times the sensitivity of super-K to the lifetime. But okay, I wrote this in the optimistic way, 10 times the sensitivity to the lifetime. But of course, the lifetime goes like the fourth power of the mass scale that this is sensitive to. And so this is really a pretty modest improvement from that point of view in terms of the mass reach. But yeah, so it'll be more than 10 years before we see that because they haven't started running yet, maybe run for 10 years. The things that we'll really see in the very near future are more EDM experiments. And so at least an order of magnitude improvement within the next couple of years, I think. And somewhat reasonable sounding plans to get more orders of magnitude on the 10-year timescale.
Thank you. And a different question. I always have a hard time to, when you do work with the dual of the axion, the two form, once the axion has the potential, the dual is not well defined. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Not really. I guess I think the sorts of statements I was making about the strings are mostly things you can ask about kind of short distance physics above, say, the QCD scale, so you don't need to think that much about the potential. So I kind of expect these weak gravity kinds of arguments are robust against the potential as long as the potential is being generated at exponentially smaller scales. But yeah, in terms of how to write the potential in terms of B, I don't have anything useful to say about that.
Thank you.
More questions? Not, I have a naive question. Global symmetries are broken. And you see how one could limit or bound the strength of the breaking of the global symmetries, if not Gage. I mean, there could be some hint of how to compute fine limits to the breaking of global symmetries.
Yeah, so you're asking if we can quantify how much
size could be broken.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would say there are two kind of proposals people have made along those lines that I think are worth mentioning. One I briefly mentioned about the black holes, and this is kind of heuristic, but maybe it can be sharpened, that we sort of expect e to the minus the entropy of the smallest black holes to be sort of a minimum amount of symmetry violation, at least for ordinary zero form symmetries. I don't know if I've seen a version of this argument applied to more general symmetries. I guess the other thing to say is that's sort of an infrared thing. We go to low energies and we see the axion has some potential that violates the shift symmetry by exponentially small amounts. But you can also ask the question about, as you go to high energies, how bad should the symmetry breaking be? And there are people who have proposed that when you hit the quantum gravity cutoff scale, all symmetries should be badly violated. So in that context, let me mention there's a paper by Clay Cordova, Kantaro Omori, and Tom Redelius. Did it come out this year, Tom? Yeah, so sometime recently, this paper by Cordova, Omori, and Redelius showed that if you start from that assumption, say that at the UV scale, all the symmetries should be badly broken, so that any approximate symmetry we see is sort of an IR effect. And you apply that to the one-form symmetries of electromagnetism, you can actually derive something like a tower version of the weak gravity conjecture from that. So I think that's a very plausible idea, that at the cutoff, everything is very badly broken. In the deep infrared, symmetries can be exponentially good, but not too exponentially good, and that some sort of black hole effects like this sort of give you a minimum amount. It would be interesting if people could quantify that more and sort of say along the whole RG flow of like how badly should a symmetry be broken.
Okay. Any more questions?
Hi. Thanks for a very nice talk. I have a simple question, I think, which is, can you clarify where quantum gravity was important in deriving the power here for the axion strings? Because anomaly inflow happens in quantum field theory and axion strings appear in quantum field theory.
Sure. Yeah, so where did the tower, where did quantum gravity enter this argument about this tower? Right, I guess it entered in a couple of places. Two of those places were when I applied the electric and magnetic axion WGC. So I used this bound on F, and I used this bound on the string tension. those were important for me to quantify the mass scale. But you're right, in any theory, I would expect axion strings to exist. And I would expect, you know, as Callan and Harvey taught us, they have these charged excitations that can circulate along the string. So it's true that in general, there are long semi-classical strings with charge zipping around on them. That does not depend on quantum gravity. But the quantitative statement about the scale at which we might expect to see them is a quantum gravity statement.
More questions? Okay, so we thank Matt again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There is coffee now, right?